OK. Bonjour tout le monde. Je suis très contente d'être avec vous, parmi vous aujourd'hui. Nous sommes très contents d'avoir avec nous Dr. Leonid Sirota, mais premièrement, Madame Joanna Barron, la directrice de la société Leonid à Toronto, et elle est la présidente de notre séance cet après-midi. Alors, sans délai, je vous présente Madame Barron.
Merci beaucoup. Welcome, everybody. As Professor Harrington mentioned, I'm from Toronto, so don't throw me out of here or throw me out of here for speaking English. But I'm really excited to welcome you all to Leonid Professor Sirota's talk, the Somme Secret de la Cour Supreme, or in English, the Dirty Little Secret of the Supreme Court of Canada. Leonid is a friend of mine and a colleague from McGill University's Faculty of Law. He clerked at the Federal Court of Canada, has a PhD and an LLM in legal theory and law from New York University School of Law, and is now a lecturer at AUT School of Law in New Zealand. So this is a rare opportunity to hear from him. As some of you may be aware, Leonid, in addition to being a full-time academic, is also a prolific blog author and is the author of one of the best regarded legal blogs in Canada, Double Aspect Blog. He writes about constitutional law primarily, and brings a really lucid and clear-minded approach to his constitutional law analysis. So I highly recommend it to you. So Leonid is going to speak for a while about the dirty little secret of the Supreme Court of Canada, and then Professor Dwight Newman and I will give some brief commentary, and then we'll open it up to questions from you. So enjoy, Leonid.
Well, thank you, Joanna, for your kind introduction. Thank you also for helping organize it. Thank you, Professor Harrington, and the Common Law Program as well. Thanks for coming. Thanks for having me. It is indeed a little bit far away for me, but I'm very happy to be able to be here. Je vais parler en anglais après beaucoup d'hésitations. J'ai décidé que je parlerai anglais aujourd'hui. Après avoir parlé français hier à McGill sur le même sujet, j'ai décidé de compléter la symétrie ou le paradoxe et parler anglais aujourd'hui à l'Université de Montréal. Mais je serais ravi de répondre aux questions dans la langue de Portalis. So, it is usually said that in Canada, originalism is not a thing. It doesn't exist insofar as it is referred to by the Supreme Court or other courts or by Canadian academics. It is usually to denigrate it, although there are some noteworthy exceptions, including Professor Newman. But by and large, originalism is treated, as Adam Dodik put it, as a dirty word in Canadian constitutional thought. And so, hence my title, I'm speaking of the dirty little secret of the Supreme Court, because actually once you start reading up on what it is that originalism really is, and once you start rereading the decisions of the Privy Council and the Supreme Court of Canada with that in mind, you realize that actually this dirty word is something that they actually use quite a bit. It is usually said that any temptation to use originalism in Canadian constitutional law has been put to rest by the Persons case, Edwards versus Attorney General of Canada, as well as by the Supreme Court's more recent, or not so recent anymore, decision in the BC Motor Vehicle Act reference. So let's briefly look at those two cases and whether they amount to a rejection of originalism. And then I will try to look a little bit, since we don't have a whole lot of time, at some of the Supreme Court's jurisprudence where, as Benjamin Oliphant and I, in a couple of papers, we have argued that actually the Supreme Court does use originalism quite a bit. Before I do that, just a few words, not enough to do it justice, but a few words on originalist theory as it has developed since it was launched or relaunched in the United States in the 70s. And as you may well know, it was initially associated quite narrowly with the conservative legal movement, with people like Ed Meese, who was Ronald Reagan's Attorney General, with people like Robert Bork, who was a judge in the United States and who was nominated but not confirmed to the Supreme Court of the United States. But originalism has evolved a great deal, you might say paradoxically, but it has evolved a great deal since then. One innovation that occurred in response to sustained criticism is that contemporary originalism does not focus on the original intent of the framers of a constitutional provision. There are different ways of doing originalism, and I will return to that a little bit, but what we think is the dominant approach now, or at least the most popular one, is what is known as the new originalism or the original public meaning originalism, in which the focus, as the name suggests, is not on the intentions, perhaps the private intentions, of the authors of a constitutional provision, but more on what the words that were actually used in the Constitution would have meant to the public at the time the Constitution was enacted. Another innovation is the recognition of the fact that even once we interpret those words as they would have been understood by the public at the time, their content might not be sufficient to dispose of all legal disputes that might occur under the Constitution. The meaning of the words might be inherently vague. They might appeal to evaluative concepts like reasonableness in, let's say, Section 1 of the Charter, or the concept of cruel and unusual punishments. And originalism has abandoned the idea, or at least largely abandoned the idea, that those vague or evaluative concepts have to be confined to the ways in which they would have been applied at the time of the enactment of the Constitution. So we might think of the idea of cruel and unusual punishments at the time when the, let's say, the U.S. Constitution was enacted and ratified. As Justice Scalia points out, the punishment of flogging would have been probably accepted as not being cruel and unusual. Justice Scalia says, well, I'm a faint-hearted originalist and I would not countenance the punishment of flogging today. I would find it cruel and unusual. And although Justice Scalia claims that he was a public meaning originalist, in fact, he was one of the most important characters in the development of public meaning originalism, others say, well, Justice Scalia, you misunderstand your own theory. Saying that being a public meaning originalist requires you to find that the punishment of flogging should have been constitutional is, you're actually thinking of the original expected applications of the term, but not of the meaning of the term. The meaning of the term requires the judge to ask him or herself what is cruel and unusual. And that can happen in an evolving fashion. So public meaning originalism, although it insists that the meaning of the words that are actually used cannot change, does not say that they must be applied in exactly the same way as they would have been applied at the time of their enactment. And once you realize that, then it turns out that all the supposed rejections of originalism in Canadian jurisprudence, or the cases that are supposedly incompatible with originalism in Canadian jurisprudence, actually don't have that sort of effect. So let's look at those cases, and let's start with the Persons case. Now, a little under a year ago, Chief Justice McLaughlin was here at the Université de Montréal at the fantastic conference that Professor Harrington and Paul Daly put up on the role of the Supreme Courts in the common law. And she, in her presentation, she discussed, among other things, the person's case. And she summarized it in a way which I think many Canadian lawyers would recognize and would accept as being true. She said, well, the Supreme Court of Canada in that case, when it had to decide whether the word qualified persons in Section 24 of the Constitution Act 1867 could embrace women as well as men, Supreme Court of Canada made an originalist decision and said that in 1867 the framers of the Constitution wouldn't have thought that, and that was the end of the story. And then the Privy Council and Viscount Sankey, who wrote the decision of the Privy Council, said, well, wait a minute, the society has evolved since 1867. Maybe at the time we didn't think that women could be senators, but the world has changed, our views of the matter have changed. Of course, women are persons, and of course, it's time to change the law. It's time, as the Chief Justice put it, to graft a new branch on the living tree. Now, the living tree is a metaphor that Viscount Sankey actually used. As we all know, he said that the British North America Act planted a living tree capable of growth and expansion within its natural limits. Apart from that, the story that the Chief Justice tells is largely unsubstantiated by the actual reading of the either the Supreme Court's decision, of which I will not say any more, or the Privy Council's decision, on which I will say a few words. Now, I will not presume to say that the Chief Justice hasn't read the decision. I will note that her colleague, her former colleague, Justice Rothstein, in a lecture that he delivered shortly after he retired at the University of Saskatchewan, very candidly admitted that he had never read the decision before preparing that lecture, and for good reason. That decision had not been cited in Canada, or almost at all, in the 50 years after it was issued, until the Charter came into force, and then the courts rediscovered this decision and found in it a purported source for an interpretive approach which Viscount Sankey would not have agreed with. And I will return to show you why I say that. But in the person's case, what actually drives the decision is not a claim that the courts are entitled to change the meaning of the Constitution in light of developing social realities and go, graft branches to the living tree. In fact, if that had been the reasoning, then the decision would have held in a single paragraph. You don't need to explain anything. You say, oh, well, the world has changed. But the decision does not hold in a single paragraph, and most of the decision is, in fact, a demonstration of the various techniques of statutory interpretation. Lord Viscount Sankey looks at how the word persons is used elsewhere in the Constitution Act. He finds that when the framers thought necessary to distinguish persons and male persons, they used the word male subjects, so they didn't use it in Section 24. He refers to other laws and to the coherence of the law. He refers to the principle inclusio unius est exclusio alterius, and he says, well, if the framers wanted to say that sex or gender is a criterion for appointment to the Senate, they would have included it in the list of criteria. They didn't do that. So it's really a fantastic statutory interpretation case because everything is there. But it's not at all a case about evolving constitutional meaning. Now, briefly, the motor vehicle reference. The motor vehicle reference has Justice Lemaire, as he then was, say, well, it's true that the civil servants who participated and played very important roles in the drafting of the Charter said that they expected the expression principles of fundamental justice in Section 7 to refer to procedural principles and not substantive ones. but we are going to more or less ignore what they said. We're not going to attach a lot of weight to that. And he gives two reasons. One, which originalists would, at least contemporary originalists, would heartily accept, is that the opinions of two of the very many authors of a constitutional text cannot be conclusive evidence even of intent of everyone who took part in the framing of that text. But the second reason that Justice Lemaire gives is that if we confine ourselves to the meaning of the term as it was at the time of the enactment, then the Constitution will not have the possibility to grow and expand and develop to meet the needs of evolving times. Now, I've tried to respond to some extent to that by saying contemporary originalism does not preclude all evolution of constitutional doctrine, although it is opposed to evolution of the meaning of the terms. It's recognizing that the meaning of the constitutional text is not the everything that there is to say about constitutional doctrine, and constitutional doctrine can evolve so long as it remains consistent with the meaning of the words that are actually used in the text. But then you could also respond in a number of other ways to this concern, and to name just one of them is, this is something that Lloyd Justice Scalia liked to repeat. It's very true that originalism limits the capacity for expansion of constitutional guarantees. But the flip side of that is that originalism also limits their capacity for contraction. People who insist on a living tree interpretation of the Constitution always assume that a living tree interpretation will expand the scope of constitutional rights, and they never give us a reason for making this assumption. They always think that the rights protections will grow and that it will, this will be a good thing. They never say why a reactionary court using a living constitutional approach would not contract the scope of constitutional rights, or indeed why the everlasting expansion of constitutional rights would not sometimes be a bad thing. For example, and that is admittedly an example I give because of my own ideological priors, you might think of something else, but the cases in which the Supreme Court decided to make up, and they very nearly say that. They say, well, the time has come to recognize the right to strike and the right to collective bargaining as a new right under the Charter. Well, you might think that's a good thing, or you might think this is not such a good thing because it imposes substantial costs on taxpayers and it gives the court the power to rewrite the Constitution. Now, again, this is an example that I give because I find those decisions to be horrendous, but you might think of something else that the Supreme Court might do that you're not going to like so much. Originalism is perhaps a pessimist approach to interpretation. You seek to confine people instead of giving them power because you're afraid that they're going to do bad things instead of being hopeful that they will do good things. All right, now, of course, saying that the person's case and the motor vehicle reference do not support, do not preclude originalism is not saying that the Supreme Court is in fact originalist. So let me give you some examples, and we canvass many more in the two papers that Ben Oliphant and I have written. One has come out in the Queen's Law Journal, the other is going to come out this summer in the UBC Law Review. So let me just give you a few examples. And we find uses of originalism in the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court of Canada, both in what we call structural cases, so cases that have to do with the division of powers, cases that have to do with other provisions of the Constitution that reflect what the Supreme Court refers to as the bargains that either have led to Confederation or to subsequent amendments to the Constitution, whether it's the enactment of the Charter or other parts of the Constitution Act 1982 or some other provisions as well. We find uses of originalism in charter cases as well, and we find that the jurisprudence that has to do with Section 96 is a very weird sort of originalism because it refers effectively to the jurisdiction of superior courts in 1867 as the measure of what is and what is not constitutional. Again, I will not say anything more about that. This is a very odd, even by originalist standards, this is a very odd thing, this Section 96 jurisprudence. But we do think that it is originalist in its own bizarre way. Now, let me say a couple of things about federalism cases, the division of power cases, and let me begin with the aeronautics reference, which was decided in 1932, just a couple of years after the Persons case, and which was written by Viscount Sankey, our great constitutional horticulturalist. Viscount Sankey reminds us that there's always a danger that as the cases and decisions of the courts in those cases accumulate, the terms of the constitutional text, and I quote, may come to be unduly extended, and attention may be diverted from what has been enacted to what has been judicially said about the enactment. And he goes on to remind us that the focus in constitutional adjudication must be on the text, and the fact that the British North America Act is a great constitutional charter means that it is all the more important not to allow general phrases to obscure the underlying object of the Act, which was to establish a federal system of government. And he continues, and I will quote him again at some length, he says, inasmuch as the Act, the Constitution Act 1867, as we now call it, embodies a compromise under which the original provinces agreed to federate, it is important to keep in mind that the preservation of the rights of minorities was a condition on which such minorities entered into the federation, and the foundation upon which the whole structure was subsequently erected. The process of interpretation, as the years go on, ought not to be allowed to dim or to whittle down the provisions of the original contract upon which the federation was founded. Nor is it legitimate that any judicial construction of the provisions of Section 91 and 92 should impose a new and different contract upon the federating bodies. So, there's a lot in this paragraph. There is a sense that federalism protects minorities, for example, and there is a sense that reinterpreting this federal agreement that protects minorities is going to put those minorities in danger. And there is a sense, which originalists insist upon, that it is illegitimate for the courts to rewrite the political agreement that gave us the Constitution, whatever that Constitution may be. The courts do not have a mandate to do that. So this is one example. Another example from just a few years after that is the one that we know as the Labour Conventions case, where the Privy Council was considering whether Parliament could use Section 132 of the BNA Act, which gave Parliament the power to implement treaties of the British Empire in Canadian law, whether Parliament could use that provision to implement treaties in which Canada had entered in its own right as a newly independent country. And Lord Atkins says, it is impossible to strain the section so as to cover this uncontemplated development. And on it goes in any number of federalism cases. The Supreme Court has largely not departed from the Privy Council's jurisprudence as it interprets the meaning of the different provisions of sections 91 and 92. Although it has, to some extent, departed from some other doctrines, that don't have to do with the interpretation of the text, but which involve the construction of supplements, if you will, to figure out how this text, once we understand what it means, how is it going to be applied in practice. Now, another category of cases that I just mentioned are the bargain cases. Let me just refer to perhaps the most recent one after the really big ones with the Senate reform reference, where the Supreme Court refers to the framers, the fathers of confederations, and how they expected the Senate to work. It doesn't refer to how the Senate actually works today. It doesn't refer to what political scientists think of the Senate, as you might expect them to do if they are concerned about making the Constitution work in light of contemporary realities. No, they just refer to the intentions of the framers about how the Senate was going to work, whether or not those intentions had been borne out by subsequent events. Supreme Court Act reference, the Nandon case, again, copious citations to the intentions of the framers of the Supreme Court Act and what they were seeking to accomplish. Rightly or wrongly, I think that the Supreme Court Act reference was a terrible decision, but the fact that they got it wrong doesn't change the fact that they used a certain methodology which focused, again, on the intentions of the framers. Let me say a couple of things about the Cajon case, in which the Supreme Court was trying to decide whether the obligation, whether the provinces of Alberta and Saskatchewan, which had been carved out of what used to be the Northwestern Territory in Rupert's Land, whether the obligation of legislative bilingualism applied to those provinces by virtue of being included within the term legal rights, which Parliament undertook to protect. Parliament, when it made the address to the Imperial Parliament that led to the constitutional amendments that eventually led to the integration of the Northwestern Territories into Canada, and then to eventually to the creation of Alberta and Saskatchewan, Parliament undertook to protect and respect the legal rights of the inhabitants of the Northwest, as it then was. And so the question was whether linguistic rights would have were encompassed by the term legal rights. The majority in Cajon looked quite carefully at whether the term legal rights would have been understood by the general public, by the legally educated public, by the Canadian government as encompassing linguistic rights. And so it referred to the way in which the term legal rights was used in 1870 when this promise was made. The dissent looked at the intention of the parties to the negotiations that brought the Northwest into Canada, and primarily not at the intentions of the Canadian government, but at the intentions of the inhabitants of the Northwest. So the dissent concluded that the inhabitants of the Northwest intended to conclude to protect their linguistic rights as well as other sorts of rights, and so for the dissent, the term legal rights had to be understood as encompassing linguistic rights. For the majority, they found that the term legal rights did not extend to linguistic rights, and so that's how they interpreted it. But the interesting thing for me is that both of those opinions are thoroughly originalist. They don't ask whether we today, in 2016 or 2015, understand the term legal rights as including language rights. They only think of either what was intended or what was understood in 1870. So despite the court's disclaimers of originalism, actually both of the dissent and the majority are thoroughly originalist. We also find many examples of originalist reasoning in charter cases, and let me just be very brief. In charter cases, the Supreme Court says that we have to refer, we have to understand the rights by referring to the purposes of those rights in the charter. But of course, a right as a legal abstraction or a philosophical abstraction doesn't have any purposes. The word says, Justice Dixon, as he then was, says in the Big M case that when we look for the purposes of the Charter of Rights, we have to refer to the historical context, we have to look to the meaning of the words, and all of those things. We're not saying that Justice or Chief Justice Dixon was actually originalist himself, but these things seem to be at least consistent with originalist approaches to constitutional interpretation. The problem is that the Supreme Court isn't very consistent in actually looking to those things. When it decides the labor rights cases, the court says, well, the right to collectively bargain and the right to strike could have been in the contemplation of the authors of the Charter because they were recognized by some international instruments that existed at the time. There is no reference to whether those rights were actually in the contemplation of the authors of the Charter, and if they were, then what did the authors of the Charter actually intend to do with them? But in other cases, the court will look at what was in the contemplation of the authors of the Charter. It will look at drafts, at past drafts. It will look at discussions. To give you just one example, in a case called Pasper, where the court is asking whether there is a right, not just a right to counsel, but whether the right to counsel for people, persons charged with an offense, includes a right to a legal aid counsel. State-funded counsel. The court says, well, actually, we know that the authors of the Charter thought about that question, and they made the choice not to include the right to legal aid as part of the right to counsel. And we, says Justice Lemaire, the same Justice Lemaire who wrote the Motor Vehicle Act reference majority opinion, we have no right to go back on that political decision that was made, we have to respect that. So, again, not saying that Justice Lemaire was an originalist, but we are saying that this particular example does appear to be something like originalism, certainly not inconsistent with originalism. So to conclude, again, we are not saying that the Supreme Court of Canada is consistently originalist or that it is consistently anything at all. In fact, it is consistently incoherent in its approach to constitutional interpretation. We generally have not thought enough about constitutional interpretation in Canada. We are content all too often to repeat platitudes about the living tree without thinking either about that particular case or about how that living tree applies in other situations. We urge all of you and all of your students for the teachers here to think a lot more than has been customary in Canada about constitutional interpretation. Because whether or not you agree that originalism is the better way to go, and we take no position on that in the papers, and I don't want to speak for my co-author, I will speak for myself. I am evolving and perhaps have evolved into an originalist. I will not speak for Ben. But whether or not you agree that originalism is the better way to go, we think that you can and should agree that a lot more intellectual rigor and a lot more consistency is necessary if you would like to remain a living tree, living constitutionalist. By all means, articulate a theory of how and when it is legitimate for the courts to change the meaning of the Constitution and why that is legitimate. Perhaps you will convince me. But in the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court of Canada, or we think in Canadian constitutional theory, those arguments have not been articulated in a satisfactory way. And so it's an invitation to further discussion, to further debate, But perhaps you will, if you take the time to starting with our papers and then looking at the originalist, very rich originalist scholarship that is coming out of the United States primarily, perhaps you will take the time to actually read that, and perhaps you will be persuaded that it is a better way to do constitutional interpretation. Thank you.
If you guys haven't met him yet, I'm also pleased to introduce Professor Dwight Newman, who is a visiting scholar here, or is that his? He is the Canada Research Chair in Constitutional and International Law at University of Saskatchewan. He was a Rhodes Scholar and holds a DPhil from Oxford. He clerked for the judge we were just speaking about, Justice Lamel, as well as Justice Lavelle at the Supreme Court of Canada. And his scholarship has been widely cited, including by the Supreme Court of Canada. And currently, he is researching the appropriate balance between resource development and Aboriginal rights. So thank you. So Dwight, do you want to start by offering some comments for Leonid?
Sure. Okay. So thank you for the chance to participate in this while I'm here at the University de Montréal. Comme les autres, je vais parler en anglais, mais je serai content de parler en français plutôt si il y a des questions en français. I'm going to simply offer a few comments in reaction to Leonid's comments and his paper, or papers, I should say. I'll offer first a comment on the insight that that they've offered. I'll offer a comment on a resulting problem, a slight qualification on things, a query, and then a consequence. And in terms of the insight that Leonid and Ben Oliphant in their papers have offered and that we've heard in today's presentation, I think that there are several important things there, but one of which is this fundamentally provocative claim that originalism is far more present in the judgments of the Supreme Court of Canada than has been acknowledged by the court itself or by those commenting upon it. That's a provocative, interesting, and important claim, and really makes these two papers, the one in the Queen's Law Journal, the other forthcoming in the UBC Law Review, very much essential reading for anyone engaged with Canadian constitutional law, I think. And so, they've done something very important in these pieces, and I commend those pieces to you. The other aspect to this insight is that there should be much more discussion about methods of constitutional interpretation in Canada. And that's something that's always the case, that there should be thought about how the Constitution is being interpreted. But there's been a particular reason identified here for why there should be much more attention to that, which is that many people go around saying that the Supreme Court of Canada has entirely rejected originalism, and there's a fundamental challenge to that. And so I think that they open up a new set of reasons for why everyone should be much more engaged with these questions of interpretation and speaking to those than has possibly been the case. In the process, they highlight implicitly a problem, which is that many people talk about originalism without necessarily understanding all of the different variations of originalism that have developed in the United States over the last couple of decades. And I'll confess to that error myself, and I had the great opportunity to spend my sabbatical year in the United States last year, and to gain much more exposure to the rich originalist scholarship that's been developing over these last couple of decades. There are many more variations on originalism than are usually discussed in Canada, even by those who are going out and deliberately commenting on originalism. And people that end up critiquing an older version of originalism really don't say anything against the new originalism that the papers reference and that's received a lot of attention. And many of the discussions of originalism in Canada are often just very oversimplified and simply not engaged with this rich originalist scholarship. And I'm hesitant to pick on him because he's offered a great jurisprudence in general, and in another piece on originalism he says much more sophisticated things. But I am going to briefly mention the judgment of Justice Binney in the Consolidated Fast Freight decision, a division of powers judgment. In a dissenting judgment, critiquing the majority judgment of Justice Rothstein, which effectively uses original meaning, Justice Binney offers a two-paragraph rejection of the judgment on the basis of its association with originalism, amongst other reasons to reject the majority judgment. But in terms of what he says on originalism, he first says that Canada has rejected originalism, which of course now has been severely questioned. And second, another paragraph on the principled reasons to reject originalism, he offers a quote from Thomas Jefferson to the effect that we wouldn't expect a grown man to wear the same coat of a child. And I wasn't aware that random quotes from Thomas Jefferson were a particularly sound source of Canadian constitutional jurisprudence to start with. The little discussion goes on, and Justice Binney talks about the warp and woof of the fabric. It's a very peculiar passage, and if that's the level at which even such an eminent justice engages in a discussion of originalism in a key Supreme Court of Canada case where that becomes a topic, it does speak to a problem in the way that Canadian academia and Canadian jurists are discussing a very prominent American constitutional theory. The little qualification that I'm going to offer in terms of what we see here is just to say, I don't know if one can be a half originalist. And so if the Supreme Court of Canada has sometimes used originalist reasoning, which I think has been demonstrated here, that probably fits better with the ultimate claim that Leonid put, that there's a degree of incoherence, than with any claim that the court has adopted originalism, which of course he didn't say. excuse me. And why I say that is simply because within originalism there's also a normative claim. If one's going to be fully originalist, it's a claim that original meaning has a particular legitimacy to it that other modes of interpretation don't. And I don't say this in any way to undermine anything about the papers. I think they say something very important in just demonstrating that the court has not rejected originalism, and that original meaning discussion is very present there. But I just offer a qualification, and it's not a qualification on what Leonid has said or that the papers say, but just against an interpretation that someone might wander into, that the court has actually partly adopted originalism. I'm not sure that that's possible to do, because there's a reason on why originalism has on the proponent's view of it, has a legitimacy that would have to extend across all judgments. And I'll come to that briefly in a second. The query that I'll put is why would one limit the scope of those cases that are said to involve bargains? Leonid's referenced the line of cases around instances where there's a constitutional bargain at stake and said this is one of the contexts, rightly said, this is one of the contexts where the court uses original meaning. The query that I'll put, and it's not a query to Leonid particularly, it's a query towards this general discussion that ought to take place, is why not think of the whole charter as bargained, for example, given that it was adopted over the views of some provinces that didn't agree with having a charter, given that it was adopted partly in exchange for the adoption of Section 92A of the Constitution Act 1982, a natural resources provision, given that there was a whole bargaining process around all of what emerged, And this speaks again to, if one's going to go an originalist route, why not extend that even more fully than the court has, given that that it's not just small bits that have been bargained, but the entire constitution. And the final point that I'll make very quickly is just to reference a consequence. I think it's implicit already in what Leonid has said, that not only do we need much more discussion about constitutional interpretation in Canada, we need much more discussion about the constitutional history of Canada, the history by which the constitutional instruments came to be adopted, for what that reflects about what some of the discussion was at the time. And I don't say that to say anything about a preference for an original intent version of originalism, which that kind of historical inquiry might be associated with, but simply to say that it offers necessary context for understanding what the thought was in the constitutional provisions and what the meaning might have been to those who adopted them. But there's a fundamental issue there, which is, if the Constitution was adopted with certain terms, what legitimacy do judges have to offer it a different meaning? And that's a fundamental question that that the paper poses, the papers pose implicitly. I think something that Canadian scholarship and jurists need to be much more engaged with. So I'll leave it at that, but I just can't commend enough the two papers as ones that I really think are essential reading for those interested in Canadian constitutionalism.
Thank you so much, Dwight. Thanks for the kind words. And well, let me say a few things, starting with the end, about the importance of history of Canadian constitutionalism. And let me start by saying that Professor Newman has written a fascinating, co-authored a fascinating paper on the history of the exclusion of property rights from the Charter. And that's one place where you might start. But I would second generally the call for more study of the history of the Canadian Constitution, both the Charter and the Constitution Act 1982. I would agree that all of the Charter and the Constitution Act 1867 are bargains, and we can see that if we look at their history. We refer in the papers to the bargain cases. Those are the cases that the Supreme Court itself identifies as involving bargains, and that, of course, begs the question, well, why those and not the others? And I agree that any constitutional instrument, if we look at the history of the Canadian constitutional texts, they are bargains. I agree with the qualification that yes, we are not saying that the Supreme Court is half originalist. There's just not enough consistency. You might maybe actually be an originalist in structural cases, but not in rights cases. That might be a defensible half originalist approach. I'm not sure it is, but at least you might argue for it. But we are certainly not saying that the Supreme Court is anything like that. And just the last thing I'll say about that Thomas Jefferson quote, of course, the context of the quote is an argument in favor of thoroughly revising a country's constitutional arrangements every 19 years. I'm not sure why 19 precisely, but that was Jefferson's argument. He said, because we cannot expect a grown man to wear the clothes that fit him as a boy, a country cannot wear, as it were, the constitution that fitted 20 years ago. And so every 19 years, we must have a complete revision of the constitution. Now, nobody has accepted that way of doing things. Certainly in Canada, we haven't accepted that way of doing things. And perhaps the corollary of our decision to stick with constitutional arrangements for a very long period of time is that, well, we can't then say that, oh, well, we actually just have committed this job of revising them to the Supreme Court. We haven't made any such decision. If you can, you know, if we have made it, other than in the Supreme Court's own decisions, by all means, show us where.
Professor Harrington?
No. I was just going to say, I know where the 20 years comes from. It's a generation.
Yeah, but why 19?
Maybe, I guess you spend a year doing it, but Jefferson, elsewhere, he talks about this in another context and talks about how no generation should be bound by earlier generations.
Yes, so yes. It just seems like a very short generation. But
well, I guess in those days, of course, 20 years is, you know, a generation.
I'm happy to pose a question, but in light of the time, do we have any audience questions? Oh, sorry. Yes.
This was really, really interesting. I appreciate it very much. And I think all Quebecers, constitutionalists, are somehow originalists, because if you look at the Labour Convention's case, the interpretation given, the very broad interpretation given to 292213 is actually based on Section 8 of the Quebec Act, which uses the very same words. And that's what the Privy Council had in mind. So in a sense, we're all originalists. I would even go so far as to say that you can be an originalist with, even in the face of an absence of text. I'm thinking of the secession efforts. It's clearly, for me, some form of originalism. The court is trying to decipher what are the most important normative principles and from where does it take them? From a short history of Canada that it provides. One that, you know, disagree with, but certainly it's all of these principles are very abstract. Still, they are ensconced in the historical trajectory of the Canadian state. That being said, and I'm not aware of the very scientific scholarship on new originalism, but at some point, aren't is new originalisms just belaboring an obvious point that history always plays a part in legal interpretation? And so trying to fit into a category what the court is doing and what I am doing, because when I'm listening to you, I'm clearly an originalist in many ways. But you can use history in an aspirational way, such as is done in the secession reference, or you can use it as a means to limit aspirational understandings that could not be held by the text of the Constitution. And there are many instances where I realize I agree with the use of history. I agree with the originalism. I think, for instance, that Justice Laforêt just crushes La Mère in the provincial remuneration, provincial court remuneration cases, where he says that it's a historical fallacy what the court is doing. And in this sense, using originalism is quite convincing. Section 96. You know, I just wrote a paper on Section 96. I mean, you're deep in ideological originalism. But then again, in other cases, I would find myself always using history, but not in the same fashion. I don't want to take too much time. But I'm just saying that what Dwight said about the Charter is also true about our Constitution of 1867. There's a text by John White in the McDonald's Commission where he says there are so many conflicting pieces in the Constitution of 1867 because it's precisely because no one agreed about anything, so they just mixed up very confusing things. So you can always harp on originalism, you're going to be faced with what kind of structure was put in place and what history has a role. Is it just an aspiration? Is it history as documentation? I think it's very very part. I agree with you that originalism is very present, but I agree with Dwight that the normative claim of originalism hasn't been very strong in Canada.
Well, so certainly there is no contradiction between originalism, being an originalist, and also resorting to analyzing constitutional principles. I think Justice Scalia is a great example of that, his thought about separation of powers, for example. How do you use history? Well, different originalists will disagree both about what are you looking for. Are you looking for the meaning of the words? Are you looking for the intentions of the framers? If you are looking at the criticism of the sort of originalism that looks to the intentions of the framers, is that they disagree. It's a large and complicated group, and they disagree. And that's why original intent originalism has been in retreat for a long time now in the US. And that's why the focus has shifted to the meaning of the words, because the meaning of the words is a much more objective inquiry. The normative argument for or against originalism, I did not really make it here, and we do not make it in the papers. I guess that would be, you know, the next paper. So I won't say anything else about that.